Hello, and welcome to PSYCO 104, X01, Basic Psychological Processes. This is the science half of introductory psychology, and it's usually taken before taking PSYCO 105, which is the arts half of intro psych. I'm your instructor, Dr. Kimberly Campbell, and in this video, I'm going to go over all of the usual first day of class housekeeping kind of information. I'll be including timestamps in the video description, if you're watching this actually on YouTube, so that you can skip ahead to the sections you're interested in or go back to sections that you want to watch again, so you don't have to listen to this whole video every time you want to look something. The three main sections for this video are going to be part one, getting to know me, your instructor, part two, the syllabus overview, where I'm going to talk about some of the textbook information, our assessment details, lecture topics, student resources, responsibilities, all that fun stuff. And then the last section is going to be all about eClass and Connect, which are mostly going to be our online resources. So, as promised, let's start with a little bit of information about me, as we're going to learn once we start talking about doing and learning from good science. It's worthwhile to critically evaluate sources of information. So you can start asking things like, who is this person who's going to be lecturing at me for the next few months? And what exactly makes her qualified to pass on the information that she's going to be sharing? So let's hop on over to a PowerPoint where we can get into some of that. Let's start with my academic credentials. Going all the way back, I got my Bachelor of Science Honors Co-op from Dalhousie University in 2013. If any of you are familiar with it, Dalhousie University is in Halifax on the east coast of Canada, so that is where I spent my younger years. And you might be interested to know, I didn't actually do my undergrad in psychology. I started off in biology. So I have a slightly varied background compared to some people in the psychological sciences, but I did lots of work with genetics and evolution and things along those lines, which might come through in some of my lectures. After that, I did switch over to psychology, and I got my Master's of Science here at the University of Alberta in 2015, and I decided to stick around, and I got my Doctor of Philosophy, my PhD, here still at U of A, in 2019, so last year. I have been a doctor for just over 1 year at this point. And I have been working with Christopher Sturdy, Dr. Sturdy, in the Songbird Neuroethology Lab. Which brings me over to my research background. So what have I been doing outside of the schooling part of things? What have I been doing research-wise? Well, for my undergrad degree, I ended up taking part in the honors program and did some undergraduate research. So, of course, it being biology, I did some more bio-based stuff, but I was sequencing DNA in single-celled organisms that I had pulled out of soil samples. So I was trying to identify different species from generic dirt samples, which is a fairly boring sounding project, and honestly doing it was fairly boring as well. If you've ever done PCR, you can know how dry that gets. But after the fact, when you kind of look back on it, and the fact that we were looking for new species and we were trying to find relationships between species, it was pretty cool research. My graduate research had absolutely nothing to do with my undergrad research. I switched over and wanted to look at communication in birds. So I've been looking at learning and communication, specifically in black-capped chickadees, which are these little guys over here. So I record their vocalizations, I analyze their vocalizations, I look at how they behave in response to vocalizations, all sorts of cool stuff. Now, I want to draw your attention to my two birds. This is Link and Sheik. These are my two conures. I am bringing them up because with working online and from home, these guys are going to be around. I'm hoping to keep them out of our recordings, but if you have ever interacted with birds, you are aware that they are not super cooperative or particularly quiet. So they might crop up in one or two recordings, And you will definitely be seeing them if you attend any of our Zoom meetings, because they're here and I'm here. So just a little bit of a heads up. Also, they're super cute, so why not? Before I get into all of the details about where we can find information and what to expect for the course, I want to take just a moment and talk about my teaching philosophy. So, an overview of how I view teaching, and it should help you figure out sort of where I'm coming from with a lot of the stuff that we're going to talk about in this video. So, I want to start off with acknowledging that online learning is new and different. It's going to be a little bit weird. There's going to be a huge learning curve because this is new for you guys, this is new for me. So it's going to be a little bit odd, and we're just going to keep that in mind, take things in stride, and try and make it as good as we can. I also have the philosophy that material should be accessible. Some of you might have noticed by now that my slides are fairly boring, and that's because early on in my teaching career, I encountered a student who had trouble telling colors apart, and color blindness is fairly common, and I really didn't want my material to be confusing for anyone. So I try and keep my slides fairly simplistic. Once I start posting things on YouTube, you can start taking advantage of things like having subtitles in the videos. You can slow the videos down so that you can listen to things at your own pace. So I'm trying to make things as comfortable and as accessible for everyone as possible. And for my last point, I want to advise you guys to make use of all of the resources that are available. I'm going to try and go out of my way to make sure that things are as clean and clear and available as possible. Try and attend our weekly Zoom meetings if you have questions. Pop by, ask some questions, get familiar with me and the TAs. Make sure you make use of our videos and the extra links. I do like to link to other videos that might give you the same information but presented in a different manner, because sometimes that's helpful. And if you're stuck, reach out to myself or our TAs. We're here to help you out, so send us an email, come to the meetings, whatever you want to do. Now, on the topic of emails, I do like to include just a couple of little slides, because this is something that I wish that I had been taught when I started as an undergrad in university. So if this is something that you already know, then maybe you're going to skip to the next section, but whatever. People aren't necessarily told how to address people in academia. It's kind of weird. Do you use doctor? Do you use instructor? Do you use professor? Which ones are correct and in which situations? So I put together a little how-to guide. So doctor is going to be simply someone who has earned a PhD or an MD. Both are called doctor. So if you look up somebody's bio and they have indicated that they have a PhD, or maybe someone's email signature indicates they have a PhD, you would be all right to call them doctor. Professor is a little bit different. So a professor is going to be someone, usually, almost always, a doctor, who has specifically been hired as a professor. So professor is more of a job title, as opposed to a stand-in for how you should address someone. So if someone is hired as a professor and is teaching your course, you could call them professor. You could also probably get away with calling them doctor, depending on their preference. And in the same vein as professor, we have instructor, which is someone who isn't necessarily a professor, but is teaching a course. So if I want to use an example and visuals, because I do enjoy my visuals here, so we have this big circle for people who you call doctors. So these are the people that have their PhDs. Professors are going to be people that are also doctors for the most part. This little dot here is me. I have not been hired as a professor, but I do have my PhD, so I count as a doctor. So my job title is actually instructor. So for me, job title being instructor, my earned title degree is doctor, but professor is not something that applies to me. So you can call me instructor or doctor. or honestly just Kimberly is fine too, but not professor. And just when I mentioned looking things up to check what you should call someone, I always use Chris, my supervisor, Dr. Sturdy, because if we check his faculty listing, we see that he's indicated he has a PhD, so we could call him doctor, but his job title is also professor, so we could call him Professor Sturdy or Dr. Sturdy, but not instructor. So on our, on our diagram here, Chris would fall in one of these circles, so professor and doctor, whereas I am instructor or doctor. Just a little FYI, that's not necessarily important to the course, but I know some people get a little bit worried when you're trying to address academic emails and you don't know how to refer to people, so little cheat sheet for you on that. Next, I want to walk through our syllabus, which you can find on eClass. Lots of information in this document, and I'm not going to cover all of it in this video, so I highly recommend that you take the time to go through it on your own at some point in the first couple of days of class. But I will try and hit all the high points right now with you guys. So it has the usual stuff at the top here, course code, me, my email address. Please pay attention to the fact that I need you to put the course number and our section number in the subject line of any emails that you send to me. I am teaching multiple courses, so it really helps me to know which class you're talking about, which section you're talking about when you're asking your questions, because that might affect the answers. I've also included sort of things like office hours, lecture time, contact info for our teaching assistants, but I'm going to scroll down for the course format section before I go into office hours and lecture time, because that's going to be a little bit different from normal when we would be meeting face to face. So if you hadn't already gathered from the announcement I've sent out, our lecture's going to be pre-recorded, so you don't have to show up at a particular place at a particular time to see the lectures. They're all going to be pre-recorded, just like this video is. And I'm going to make them available on eClass for you to view online at your convenience. So you don't have to come to our normally scheduled lecture times, though that brings me to the next point about office hours slash live meetings, which is that I'm maintaining our normal class time, Wednesdays at 5:30 p.m., and we'll be holding completely optional Zoom meetings live during those periods. So if you have questions and you want to come talk to me or the TAs, you can show up during those meetings and do so. So there will be a link on our eClass leading to the Zoom meetings, as well as all of our policies for those meetings, which we'll get to when we head over to eClass. But mostly, I just want to stress that these meetings aren't mandatory. You don't physically have to be there. I'm not taking attendance or anything like that. And I will not be recording these, so I'm not going to have access to a backlog of whatever we talked about at any of these meetings. So if you want to come, you are more than welcome to, but don't feel like you have to. And for our last portion here in course format, I have our evaluations. So things like our tests, assignments, the details of which we'll cover just a little bit further down the page here, everything's going to be done online. None of this course is going to be done in person. Everything is remote delivery, so that's all there. The next section I want to draw your attention to is the technological requirements, the recommendations for remote learning, which basically is going to tell you that you need to have a computer and internet connection for this class, because it's an online course and it's being run over the internet. This is going to be especially important for our online exams and quizzes, mostly the exams, where they tend not to work as well if you're using something like a tablet or a cell phone. You're really going to want to have a computer or a laptop, but make sure you check out the recommended technology there and reach out to me before the add drop deadline if you're going to have an issue with that. For our textbook, we're going to be using the 7th Canadian edition of Psychology, Frontiers and Applications. This is a new edition. So in the past we've used previous editions, most recently the 6th edition, but they came out with a new edition that has some new information, new resources. Specifically, what we care about is that it comes with Connect. So when you're purchasing the textbook from either the bookstore on campus, obviously through the online links, which I have included on our eClass, or you can actually purchase directly through the publishers, McGraw-Hill, those are going to be coming with a Connect code, which gives you access to the online resources that come with the textbook, so a digital copy of the textbook, access to smart readings, extra videos, a bunch of resources like that, and what we care about, which is going to be access to the quizzes that we're going to be doing throughout the term. So for each chapter, we're going to be doing a quiz, and you're going to access that through Connect. So I'll show you that very briefly later on in the video. I've had a couple of people ask if they can use older versions of the textbook, and the answer is technically, if you already have a copy of an older version of the textbook, you can make use of that because most of the information should be fairly similar to what we're using. The problem there being that older editions don't come with Connect. So you would still have to get access to Connect to be able to complete the quizzes. So older versions are kind of helpful if you already have them, but I wouldn't recommend purchasing. And I also include here our section web address, which is our Connect web address that'll get you to our specific courses Connect session so that you can register and access our specific quizzes so that everything can go back to your grades when I'm calculating everything at the end of term. The next important thing to point out is our important dates, our add drop deadline, the refund deadline, and the final withdraw date. You're going to want to make sure that you know these dates just in case you have to add or drop a class or withdraw from a course at any point. Those are always good to know. And for other useful information that you can find in the syllabus, we have the section on lecture schedule and assigned readings, which is basically the summary of what we're going to be doing throughout the whole term. So it's going to include which chapters we're covering, which weeks, when we have assignments and midterms. So this is a really good resource to keep an eye on as we move throughout the term. This section here lists the weighting for all of our different assessments for the term. So we have our midterms. There's going to be two of them, each are worth 20%. We also have a written assignment, which I will talk about in detail after we have our first midterm. I always like to give you guys a little bit of time to settle in and get used to what's going on in the course before I actually introduce our written assignment. But as just a little blurb about it right now, the written assignment is going to involve reading a simple scientific article and summarizing that article by answering a couple of questions. Not meant to be too complicated, just to give you a little bit of experience with scientific literature and dabbling your toes into writing. I've already mentioned our chapter quizzes. There's going to be 10 of those, and they're run through Connect, as I mentioned. It's going to be one for each chapter, but we're only covering 9 chapters, so the extra quiz is actually coming from the fact that chapter 2 includes a little bit of extra statistical material. And I decided to include a very short quiz on some of that stuff. So that's mostly drawn from our statistics appendix in the textbook. And so that quiz is going to be quite a bit shorter and simpler than the others, but it brings us up to a nice even 10 quizzes to get our 15% grade there. There's also going to be research participation. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail about this here because there will be a more detailed video up on eClass that's going to come from our research coordinator who's running the program. But the short version of it is that research participation is basically the lab component of the course. So this is going to be how you get some hands-on experience with research by actually participating in research. So you will sign up for online research studies that are being run through the department. Most of them will probably involve things like answering questions in a survey or something like that. But you'll sign up for a couple of those, and in return for your participation, you can earn up to 10% of your final grade. And then our last assessment component is the final exam, which is worth 30%. The next section is going to give us a little bit more detail on each of those assessments. We already went over our written assignment. For the chapter quizzes, we have again our Connect link here. Each of the quizzes will be due on Friday nights at 11:59 p.m. MST, which is local Edmonton time, so basically just before midnight. It's not going to be every Friday, it's just going to be whenever there's a Friday that lines up with us completing a chapter. So the dates are listed here so that you can see those as we move throughout the course. The dates will also be listed in Connect so that when you log in, you can see when each of the quizzes are due. I do want to draw your attention to the fact that our stats appendix quiz, that extra small quiz I just mentioned, is going to be due on the same day as our Chapter 2 quiz, so make sure that when you're doing a Chapter 2 quiz that you continue on and complete the stats quiz as well. It's just going to be a nice quick one, so it won't take as long as the others, but none of them are going to be too long. And it isn't stated here in the chapter quizzes description, but they're set up on Connect so that they're going to be open book. It's not going to lock you out of, say, going to another tab or looking at your notes or anything like that. And there's no time limit on those. The chapter quizzes aren't meant to be a high stress situation. They're mostly just to make sure that you're actually keeping up with the material as we're going through it in class. For our midterms, they're going to be both multiple choice and short answer questions. They're going to be completed on eClass. They're going to fall specifically within the time period that we have scheduled for our class. So you have to write them within a constrained time period, as listed in the dates list just above. But unlike some other classes, there aren't going to be any active electronic proctoring programs, so these exams are going to be designed to be open book. And what that means is that if you want to look at your notes, you can go ahead and do that. To counteract the fact that you could then theoretically look up every single question, they're going to be a little bit tighter on time so that you can't take the time to look up every single question. And as we get closer to our midterms, I'll give you the specifics on how many questions we're going to have and what our time constraints are going to look like. But this is just to give you a basic idea of that. And I do specify that the questions can come from textbook or lecture material. Either of them are testable, because you'll notice if you're following along in the textbook, the lectures aren't going to cover absolutely everything in the textbook. So there are other things that you should also be aware of. And the final exam is going to be very similar to the midterms, except the midterms are not cumulative, meaning that once you've been tested on a midterm for it, for the next midterm, you don't need to know the material you had studied for previously. You just need to know the new stuff. But the final exam is going to be cumulative, which means I'm going to test you on material for things that you've learned throughout the whole semester. But other than that, everything else will be the same. Multiple choice and short answers both together on eClass. No online proctoring, but a tighter time constraint to compensate for that. And students always ask about representative evaluative material, which is the fancy way of saying practice questions. And I will put up a practice exam on eClass, usually about a week before our midterms and the final, just to give you a chance to play around with the system, see what it's going to look like when you're in one of those testing scenarios, and give you some questions to look at. They should be very similar to what you're seeing in the quizzes, just maybe a little bit more comprehensive. Comprehension intensive. Another important point to look at is what happens if you have to miss an exam, a quiz, an assignment. So if you have a religious conflict, maybe something's falling on a holiday, let me know as soon as possible and we can arrange to rearrange that. If something comes up, maybe you are ill or your internet crashes or something like that, let me know as soon as physically possible. The rule of thumb is I need to know about it within 24 hours, but the sooner you can tell me, the better. In terms of the exams, meaning the midterms or the final exam, for the midterms, I would likely go the route of deferring the weight of those midterms, meaning that if you miss writing the midterm and I have deemed it an excused absence, then that 20% that you would have earned for that midterm, we're just going to shift that weight to the final exam. So you don't have to rewrite, because there are quite a few of you and it gets difficult to arrange. We'll just shift the weight to the final because it's a cumulative final. For the assignments, I would prefer to be able to reschedule those if at all possible. Again, it's a lot easier to do if you let me know in advance that you need an extension or something like that. We will deal with that as a case-by-case basis if it's necessary. The final exam is a little bit more complicated than that because I don't determine if something is an excused absence. You can apply for a deferral of the final exam, but it has to go through the department. So that's a little bit more involved of a process, and the details for that are here. The last little bit of the syllabus here goes into student responsibilities and student resources. So a lot of this stuff I would recommend that you read through in depth. I'm just going to hit some of the highlights because we've spent quite a bit of time on the syllabus already. So we have some outlines or guidelines for online engagement. So things like how to conduct yourself online, how to behave in a Zoom meeting or in online forums, that sort of thing. But basically just be polite, be considerate, be respectful. Don't say things that you shouldn't say, those sort of things. We have the usual academic integrity stuff. This is especially important with online work because it's easy to look things up. It's easy to think that you can just copy and paste stuff, but copying and pasting is an academic integrity issue. That's plagiarism, and it can get you a zero on the assignment, the assessment, or even in the course. So please, please, please make sure you understand how academic integrity works. Make sure you know what plagiarism is so that you're not doing it, because it can have some pretty negative consequences. And for our exams, I am specifically making them open book, but that doesn't mean that you can work in a group, that you can have a whole bunch of people working together. Please complete them independently and make sure that all of your written responses are in your own words. Coming back to plagiarism. So read up on this, Code of Student Behavior, Conduct of Exams. All these links here lead to pages outlining what you should and shouldn't do behavior-wise. And this one here is kind of important, again, especially with online courses, with the recording and or distribution of course materials. So it's basically saying that I am creating all of the course materials. I'm making these recordings. I am making my own slides and I'm putting them out there for you to use, but that doesn't mean that you can share them. So these are under copyright by me and you cannot share them without consent of the author, which is me. And that leads us into our resources. So the link to the COVID information website, student resources, accessibility. I will go into a little bit more detail here because there are usually a couple of students in the course with accessibility accommodations. For most of our online stuff, things like accommodations mean extra time to exams. That's fairly simple to do, so I will be notified of your accommodation requirements and I'll add the extra time to your exam. It doesn't involve a different setting or anything like that. You start at the same time as everyone else. Your exam just runs a little bit longer. I already mentioned the fact that I like to try and make my resources a little bit more accessible. They should be fairly colorblind friendly. I'm going to try and have subtitles, all that sort of stuff. So trying to accommodate everybody as much as possible. And if there's any way I can assist with that, make sure you reach out to me because I am absolutely open to trying to make those changes. We also have our Academic Success Center, Center for Writers, People's First House, which is a very nice place, Health and Wellness Support, all sorts of links here. So again, make sure that you read through this document. There is way more information than I can cover in this one video without absolutely boring you completely to sleep. So we will leave the syllabus here and we will hop over to eClass and then connect for just a really quick overview of the resources that are there. So here is our eClass page. Yours might look just a little bit different because this is the instructor one. I don't have a student view, so there's a couple of things here that are going to look just a little bit different, and that's because I can edit these things. But a lot of this information is going to be very similar to our syllabus because I just copied it over. So my information, my email address, our TA's emails are here as well. At the top of the page, we also have our announcements. So that's where you can go to check out any announcements that I've shared with the class. Those announcements will also come to your U of A email address. So make sure you're checking for those as well, because that's where I'm going to share important information, like stuff about upcoming midterms, or if I get a bunch of questions from students and I feel like everyone might want to know the answer, I'll make an announcement. This is also where you can find our syllabus document. Below that, we have the live meetings section. So this is where all the information is for our Zoom meetings. So I have the procedure for how these meetings are going to work, a list of etiquette guidelines that you should take a look at before joining these meetings, and then the link to those meetings as well. So if you want to come to these optional Zoom meetings, you want to chat with myself or RTAs, if you have questions, that kind of thing, all of those resources are there. I encourage you to take a look. Below that, we have our day one section, which is where you found this video. Below that are textbook details, which we already covered in our syllabus. Then we have our connect links. So there are a couple of things here. The first is the link that will take you directly to connect. This will not work until you have specifically registered for our course. So I put it at the top because that's the link you're going to be using very consistently after the first couple of days. But first off, you want to go to the ones below that where I have our connect information and registration instructions. There are both a set of slides as well as a video going over that information. And below that, we have our specific course connect URL. So this is the link that connect wants you to follow to register for our specific class. And that link opens up on September 1st, so if you had tried it prior to the first day of September, it hasn't worked, but it will work now. We will eventually have practice exams and the actual exams listed below that, but those are not yet available for you guys. And then below that, I have a breakdown for each week of the course. I've found that it's easiest to put everything together by week, so I've listed week one, plus what chapters we're covering, and then in that section I'll give you the resources, the slides that go with those chapters, as well as any video links for me talking about those slides. So that was eClass, and this is Connect. I've swapped over to the student view, so it should look fairly similar to what you guys will see when you've logged into Connect and specifically clicked into our class. We'll list all 10 of our quizzes and which chapters they're coming from, as well as what date they are due on. I have specifically set everything up so that every single quiz opens up on September 1st, our first day of term. So if you wanted to, there is absolutely nothing stopping you from running through all of these quizzes day one, or in the first week, or in the first 2 weeks. As long as you finish before the due dates that are listed in the syllabus and here on Connect, you are free to do these at your own pace. I also want to draw your attention to the bottom here, where they also have this folder for smart book reading assignments. These are completely optional study resources, but they are basically small quizzes that can help you as you're reading through the textbook. So it'll point out different concepts that you're struggling with and help you build towards learning those. So if that's the kind of resource that helps you with learning, if you like that kind of constant feedback, it's a really nicely integrated feature that'll work with the digital version of the textbook, so you can work through the text that way instead of just reading page after page of text. So I point out that those are there, and there is one for each chapter. You won't find one for the stats appendix, just because there isn't really that much to it. But each chapter gets its own, and you can check those out if that's something you're interested in. And that is it. I hope that you found this information useful. I hope you now feel like you know where some of our information is, or where you can look to find the information that you need. But I look forward to working with all of you this semester, and I might see you at our next Zoom meeting. Bye for now.